I feel like my sermon needs to just be a footnote to Karen's faith moment, to repair and mend what is torn and broken. That's it. That's the heart of Advent. That is the heart of Jesus Christ's coming at Christmas and of his work in the world. There is so much demand for our attention these days. If it's not the kids or the parents, then it's the ring or the buzz or the ping of the phone. If it's not the phone, then it's the to-do list and all the necessities of the coming holiday. If not the holiday, then it's what the house needs, or the church needs, or this worthy cause, or that one. And then how can our attention not be drawn to some extent onto the latest and craziest moments in the news? A president impeached, a Congress divided, this violent attack, that terrible injustice, concerns about what might be coming with the economy or trying to figure out what's up with the Patriots. And the roles, all the roles we try to faithfully play, the parental role and the spousal role and the work role and the community member role and the responsible citizen role. We can excel in some of our roles, but at times we leave a lot to be desired in our other roles. And always in every role we could be better, couldn't we? We could always be better. There is so much demand for our attention. The season of Advent leading up to Christmas asks for our attention too, but as we heard from Isaiah and the Gospel of Matthew, it's attention of a different order that is asked of us. Not an added burden to the anxious ridden here and now, but an invitation to glance towards the future, a promised future of less stress and greater peace, of less striving and more being, of less noise and more quietness, of less rancor and more love, a future of more mending and less discarding, of less pridefulness and more humility, of less taking and more giving, of fewer walls and more bridges, of fewer lies and more truth. We are often told in our modern day climate of supplying and demanding, of producing and consuming, that the path of mental health and spiritual growth and psychological well-being is by way of mindfulness, of being present to the moment, relinquishing the hooks of the past and the lures and concerns of the future. And for certain, there is value to that. But the season of Advent that our Christian tradition frames for us, based upon our rootedness in the Jewish revelation of God and the Jewish Messiah therein, charts something of a different course for our spiritual path. It says that what the present moment needs is a taste, a foreshadowing of the future moment to come. Foreshadowing of the promised future. Not to rescue us from the present, not to give us a way to avoid or deny it, or distract us from the present, to escape from the present moment. Because when the present moment is hard and painful and tedious and scary, the temptation to escape it is big. But the taste of the future moment, as named by Isaiah, the wolf lying with the lamb and peace and no violence on the holy mountain, and sung by the psalmist, wait and watch for the Lord is good. And screamed in the wilderness by John, repent for the kingdom of God is here, is near, is here, is coming. All of this is a taste, a reminder of the coming fulfillment of all things, the righting of all wrongs, the resolving of all discord, the victory of truth, the healing of our damaged planet, the vindication of the abused and oppressed. That's the taste of the future. There is something beautiful about hoping towards that future of which we dream and of which our faith paints beautiful pictures, and then allowing that hope to circle back on oneself, to calm the nerves of the present, to settle our sense of responsibility for saving the whole world, to simply inspire simple acts of care, to relax us into watching and waiting and trusting for God's hand to move. If there is a silent and holy night to come, a time when the wolf will lie down with the lamb, when the Christ, the Prince of Peace, will usher in a new day to bless us and to bless the world, then how does that call us to live now? Rather than cleaning our hands of it all, well, it'll all be made right in the end, I'm not responsible for it, or abdicating our responsibility, could that vision, that taste foreshadowing of the future, inspire us to participate in its arrival here and now? That is the idea of Advent. Isaiah's pointing us to the future, Christ's resurrection, promise of a new heaven and earth, are a gift-wrapped vision of where it's all going. This is the promise of where it's all going, not to hell in a handbasket, no, but to heaven in an abundant cornucopia basket. Ideally, it's a vision that elicits from us relief, thank God, or gratitude, thank you, God, and a sense of hope, which inspires us to do what we can now to contribute to that beautiful future's becoming, even if it's gold thread around a patch in our jeans. Anne Lamott has a book called Stitches, which speaks of hope in this way. She says, every time we choose the good action or response, every time we choose the decent, the valuable, it builds incrementally towards renewal, resurrection, a place of newness, freedom, justice. That's the equation, she says. Life, death, resurrection, hope. The horror is real. So you make your casserole, you organize a food drive, you do the laundry for your family. You just do what you can. And then she tells this little parable. A sparrow was lying in the street with its legs straight up in the air. A war horse walks up and asks the bird, "What on earth are you doing?" "I heard the sky was falling and I wanted to help," she replies. The horse laughs a big, loud, sneering horse laugh and says, "You really think you're going to hold back the sky with those scrawny little legs?" The sparrow replies, "One does what one can." That's hope. That's Advent. That's allowing the future to inspire the present. Doing what you can while trusting God to do the rest.